And then, you know, we have Zamir. Zamir was very recently working with Raymond. And Raymond's, as you know, is into offline retail. So I would want him to give a contrary view that how, what's the stress, okay, between offline retail, online retail, and how does he look at the various legal issues which are impacting the online retail? How does he favors them or disfavors them? Give some contrary view from, you know, offline and retail standpoint. And then at last, I know that, you know, we have audience who are from law firm as well as from in-house, and I'm sure they would have some sort of aspirations or expectation to work with them either as outside counsel or in-house counsel. I'll ask them that, you know, what would be their expectation from outside counsels, and if they are hiring somebody in their own department, what are the key skill set expectation they have from them, so that you guys can take back something for your own career progression. I hope that's fine with you. Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, I remember that when my first session on e-commerce was sometime in 2005 or 2006, and at that point of time, I had to actually ask the audience for a show of hand that who all have ever bought anything online. And I mean, trust me, I didn't even see more than 10 to 15% hands to go up. And I'm sure if I ask the same question right now, the audience is going to sue me for defamation. That you think that we are so stupid that we are not buying online? So that's the change in terms of the depth of the industry. So that's on the business side. And, you know, I mean, and when we used to, so when I joined eBay, I think sometime in 2005, they were building up the business. And when we used to approach to the various retailers to come and sell online or to various large business houses, so their perception of the online online industry, especially e-commerce, was, you know, these are just next door kids who are just playing some video games on internet. And we never used to get that kind of a respect from the business community who were not part of the e-commerce ecosystem. That some small kids and they have built some sort of a video game on internet and, you know, they are playing. So they never used to, you know, take us seriously. But now you all know that e-commerce industry has completely disrupted how the retail transaction or retail business has been done in India, and people are taking them very, very seriously, and not seriously, they are taking them as a real threat to their own, you know, on existence. So that's on the business side. And, you know, I'm just trying to explain to you how, for me, the world has changed over the last 14 years of my association in this industry. Coming to the maturity of the legal ecosystem, so I remember in 2004 and 5 when e-commerce just started to grow in India, there were no to very, very minimal, I mean, regulations. In fact, the only regulation at that point of time or law at that point of time we had, and which I used to go and talk about it, okay, before regulators and law enforcement, was the Information Technology Act. And only Section 79 was there in the old form, which was not as flexible as what we see right now. That's the only thing which, you know, I used to tell to all regulators and law enforcement, that, you know, we are technically covered under Information Technology Act and we are an intermediary under Section 79 without any rules and all. But from there, when we saw the growth of the business, both in terms of the value of GMV, the number of investment coming in, opening up of the online payment space, so gradually we saw the regulation or legal ecosystem also improving and becoming mature. Similarly, I mean, I don't know whether I would say I had the benefit or I was part of India's first intermediary litigation in eBay stroke Bazi, when the then CEO was arrested because some third party sold a child pornography CD online. And that was the litigation which completely redefined the legal jurisprudence on the intermediary liability. And then we saw the regulations to come into the online payment space, whether, you know, they are payment intermediaries or prepaid payment instrument and stuff like that. We saw the regulations to come under the consumer protection law, we saw the regulations to come under the food and drugs law, so on and so forth. Now, like, you know, all the industries have some element of footprints on e-commerce, and the government are trying to introduce some regulation to make sure that there is orderly growth of e-commerce in those kind of specific your industry. And last but not the least, some sort of funny aspect, when I used to deal a lot with law enforcement, because eBay was a completely open kind of a marketplace, a lot more open than Snapdeal. And that platform was used for good thing as well as for bad things. You know, people used to sell something like phone, but they used to ship like soap, and you know, we saw plenty of misuse of credit cards and stuff like that. So and we also saw some issue in terms of data protection. So I remember one case where I approached a local cop. I don't know whether it was in Bombay or in Delhi. And it was something in relation to data. So we had to file some complaint that somebody is trying to misuse data and try to copy it and all. So I filed the complaint, and when I went to meet the ACP, he said that, hey, you are such a big company and you have come to file a complaint because somebody has taken a CD-ROM which costs just 25 rupees and you are worried about the cost of a CD-ROM of 25 rupees. So I had to explain to him that this is not about cost of a CD-ROM of 25 rupees. This is about the valuable information and data which is being stored and which might have been misused, okay, by someone. So that was the level of understanding and maturity. And I do understand that in you know, one of our discussion with somebody in judiciary, and we started to talk about computer viruses. And I'm talking about sometime in 2004 and 5. It's not like very recent. So I do remember that somebody said that, hey, if there is any virus in the computer, I will not touch that computer because I may also get infected. And here we are, where I think the level of understanding of law enforcement and judiciary about internet and technology, both in terms of legal ecosystem and also law enforcement, is very, very mature. We know how they are handling now difficult issues on social media apps, on social communication apps. So I think the world has changed dramatically, and India is now setting the examples for the world in terms of how to really balance the interest of business and balance the interest of regulation and law enforcement. So I think that's a bit kind of a history and how things have changed, at least in front of my eyes over last 14 years. What I'll do is that I'll first start with Smriti, and will ask her to share her views that how is the business doing in terms of the ever-changing regulation, especially the new FDI. I won't say regulation, the reinterpretation of the existing regulations, the talks happening in terms of the data privacy, the ever-evolving payment regulation and stuff like that. How are you really making sure that you are giving the right advice and your business is growing in this ever-changing and complex ecosystem from all standpoint?
How much time do I have?
Yeah, please.
So thank you all for being here. First, I completely agree with Ashish. E-commerce as a space is extremely exciting to be in for multiple reasons. Technology, innovation in technology, how it changes social and consumer behavior, how material it is to MSMEs and growth in economy, just by reaching out and increasing the network for any seller or any buyer today. That's what's exciting about e-commerce. I think no one can negate today the importance of e-commerce in our economic growth of the country, because it gives somebody a path to distribute without really having to work under a constrained distribution channel as it used to be earlier. What e-commerce does is it takes away powers from the hands of the brand, it takes away powers from the hands of the distribution network, and it gives power to consumers and sellers, and that is incredibly liberating. What e-commerce does is that it tries to create a consumer-free market. Now, when we talk about all these concepts about freedom and consumers and pricing, obviously it comes with a whole host of regulation, and that is where the challenges come. So if we were to talk about regulatory challenges, there are multiple aspects of the regulatory challenges. One is from the capital perspective, which is where Ashish just briefly touched upon the FDI. And it's very topical today to talk about FDI because of the recent press note too. I don't know how many of you are aware of it, but then there has been a whole discussion and a lot of media bites on what press note 2 means, what it means for some companies like Amazon Flipkart versus others, and so on and so forth, as well as for the fact that there is a new e-commerce policy in place. Of course, new e-commerce policy has many aspects, including FDI, but let's just talk about FDI. As Ashish sort of said, let's talk a little bit about what press note 2 is all about. To our mind, Press Note 2 is not very different from Press Note 3 and is not very inconsistent with the broader intent of the government until now with regard to retail trade in India. For the longest time, FDI in retail was not allowed, and as you're aware, in multi-brand retailing, FDI more than 50% is still not allowed. Why is that so? It is with the intent of protecting domestic retail trade and MSME sector in India, and that is a broader objective. When e-commerce in its own avatar came into being, the government said, well, no inventory. We will allow you to run a marketplace which will allow people to sell on your marketplace, but you cannot be doing business under the garb of running e-commerce, an inventory-led model. And that was your press note 3. And I'm sort of paraphrasing everything, and allow me the liberty of doing so. And please correct me if I have a gap. And that was press note 3 for you. Well, that Press Note 3 had its own issues in terms of enforcement. People would read it differently. And Press Note 2 further emphasizes on the fact that you should and put a new test to the control factor. What could deem to be an inventory-led model? That you should not control inventory. You should not own equity in any seller on the platform. It has just put that threshold slightly higher. But the intent, as we see from the government, has been very consistent, saying that we want to protect domestic industry, domestic retail, and it is not yet ready for capital dumping from the foreign investors. However, it is also to be acknowledged at the same time that the startup ecosystem, especially as far as e-commerce, has had the growth factor coming in from foreign capital. It is not domestic capital which has actually grown the sector yet. So given now these new changes, and probably Arun is better placed to talk about it later, how this would impact a foreign investor as they look at e-commerce in India as a potential new ground. It is a very exciting market to be in, obviously one of the world's largest market with a very high growth for internet adopters as we go along over the last 4 years, over the last 1 year, about 18 months. With Jio coming in, I think we've had more internet adopters than in any other time in this entire country. So today, tier 2, tier 3 profiles of people really doesn't matter. You are on the road, you will see every person with a Jio phone, right? And he is watching content, which is what Ashish does. And he's watching, you know, he's buying things. He buys things which he could never access. He never knew what exists. So I will, on a lighter note, I'll probably over here talk about a category of products called sexual wellness products. Now, as a product, it never sells in India in a retail market because people can't access it and they find it very uncomfortable going out in the market and buying. Now, today with e-commerce, people are buying it. Now, that also leads to another debate on morality and, you know, whether it is right to do or not right to do. And that is kind of an example of the challenge of e-commerce, because e-commerce exposes everything, makes everything more visible. It is not a behavior that is coming into play because e-commerce is there, but e-commerce is making some consumer behaviors more visible. So that leads me to the part about talking about how e-commerce as an enterprise is leading to data aggregation, data collection, which is a very important asset going forward for any other company. So if a brand is working with an e-commerce, it has invaluable data as far as consumer behavior is concerned. And when we are talking about data, of course, we know all the discussion that is happening around data, anonymization of data, who owns data, compulsory licensing of data being a property of the government or not, And national e-commerce policy has sort of put it all out there. So obviously, as an e-commerce company, we are very closely watching and being a part of that discussion to ensure that we actually have the ability as an e-commerce company to be able to collect data, use it, monetize it for the benefit of the society, for the benefit of every stakeholder that is there in the industry. But that, of course, comes with a lot of challenge around it, especially with technology and how data is used, hacked, data security issues, so on and so forth. And there is a whole host of things. And I think Ashish's example was about one instance where we had a data theft. One major part of e-commerce and the challenge for e-commerce is around consumer interests, right? And that is what, as a regulator, the main focus is when they're trying to regulate e-commerce. Now, consumer interests are in two parts. I think one of the major issues which is spoken about is about counterfeiting being more visible or more prevalent because of e-commerce. And I keep saying this, counterfeiting is not an issue of e-commerce. Counterfeiting is an issue generically. You have counterfeiting in real world as much as you have counterfeiting online. They have just found another channel to sell counterfeiting, so maybe more of it sells or maybe more of it is visible. So if you go to a Sarojini Nagar, you will find a counterfeit. If you go to any of the e-commerce website, you will find a counterfeit. But today, it has become more fancy. You can't go and sue Sarojini Nagar market, but you can definitely sue a Facebook or a Snapdeal or a, whoever else. So this particular discussion around what is the role of a marketplace, which is about an intermediary, is something that is constantly evolving.
I'm just doing some time check over here. So maybe
sorry,
next 30 seconds. Yeah.
So I think I will have more questions coming from Vaishali over there who we quickly chatted about. But counterfeiting as an issue, the role of intermediary as an issue, is all something that's a challenge for us as well as an opportunity. So like I said to Ashish, how much time do you have? It's a very wide subject. And of course, we can all talk about it in our rest of the time.
Thanks, Mithi. Arun, so I think we have the title as tips and challenges. While I know that you want to talk about challenges, but do spare some time if anybody has some good business tips and want to take some sort of checks from you. So that should be the good tip.
I can take it from them.
Yeah, no, reverse. You are the investor. But yeah, please go ahead and share your perspective.
So I think I'll try and stay more focused on the FDI perspective and the challenges in the e-commerce space over the past, what I've seen over the past 7 years, right? So I'll pick up on what Smriti briefly touched upon, which is the fact that foreign investment has virtually been responsible for building the entire Indian e-commerce ecosystem, right? Over the past decade or so, be it Amazon, be it Flipkart, Snapdeal, ShopClues, all these companies have grown. Flipkart as we all know, it's the single largest acquisition in our history, close to $20 billion. All of this has happened and has been possible because of foreign investment, right? So that's the context that I want you to have in the back of your mind. And I want to talk about, say, three primary challenges that we have when I look at it as an investor from an FDI perspective, when I look at this space. So in that light, I think we live in this really strange world where e-commerce has received significant amount of foreign investment. There's been talk of progressive liberalization of foreign investment regulations in India. There's been talk about ease of doing business in India and sort of moving up the rankings. But e-commerce seems to be sort of that, problem child for whom the regulations have moved in the opposite direction, especially for companies which have foreign investment, right? So I think my first fundamental problem looking at it as an investor is that we have a highly discriminatory framework for companies which are raising money from domestic capital and domestic investors and companies which are raising capital from foreign investors. And this is despite the fact that foreign investment has been virtually responsible for whatever growth we have seen in this space, and domestic capital has not really contributed, right? So I think that in itself is the biggest macro challenge. And over the years, every other sector has seen liberalization, including single brand retail and multi-brand retail in some shape or form. But e-commerce is one of those, it's the only sector where I would say we've had this consistent ban on inventory-based e-commerce. I'm happy to be educated about it, but I'm yet to see the empirical evidence suggesting that it's a very bad thing for retailers or traders. In fact, I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that with the advent of the Amazons, Flipkarts, and the Snapdeals of this world, traders have in fact benefited from the existence of e-commerce, especially those traders in tier 2, tier 3 cities, right? So I think there's empirical evidence to suggest that it's actually a positive development, right? So that's the first challenge. The second challenge is, you know, I think from a foreign investor's perspective, is stability of regulations or certainty of regulations. So, okay, fine, we have a model where inventory-based e-commerce is not permitted. Sure, we've all made our peace with it. You continue to invest. You have a marketplace framework. You know, I think the first time that we had comprehensive guidelines introduced was in March 2016, where the first press note came out around what a marketplace can do, what is an e-commerce marketplace, you know, what are the restrictions associated with it, etc. That was introduced in March 2016. And I want to just pick on one particular aspect of that policy in March 2016, which is that it focused on diversification of sellers on a platform. It said you need to have a diverse set of sellers on the platform. That is when you're truly a marketplace, right? Otherwise, you're just sort of a pseudo-inventory led business. Now, fine, without getting into the rationale of whether that's, you know, without getting into sort of the underlying rationale, whether that's right, wrong, at least you had some guidelines. And, you know, I think Ashish and Smriti were sort of smack in the middle of it at some way in terms of figuring out the compliance framework with that particular press note. And it was a challenging environment. But over a period of time, say 6 months, 8 months, a lot of companies were able to figure out, okay, this is the way we operate in the context of this press note, right? So you had your challenges, but you had a stable policy and you had a stable compliance framework, right? Now, if you now go back a few months ago, which is, I think, we had the press note that Smriti spoke about, we had a new press note in December 2018, around 26-28 December, which came into force in February, which is like 2 months, right? Where you totally changed this focus on diversification of sellers to diversification of procurement, which is something that you really even can't control as an e-commerce marketplace, right? So how, when you look at it as an investment, you know, as an investor, how do I know that this is not going to go from A to B to C, which are all diametrically opposite in terms of the underlying principle of what you're trying to protect or what you're trying to do, right? So that is a really, really significant challenge. And also, frankly, it's come out in such a way that, you know, people are struggling with compliance. People are struggling to figure out how to comply, right? How do I change my business model, right? And you also need to bear in mind that, you know, companies have a set business model. They've taken time. They have, over the almost past 3 years since the first press note, they have put in place a set operating framework, a set way of doing business, right? And lawyers in-house and external have figured out the right framework to look at those regulations and how do you comply, and diligence, etc., were going on that basis. Now, you've completely uprooted that and overhauled it, and you've not really provided guidance around how do you even comply with the new framework. And it's, to be honest, 2 months is a very, very, very short period to be able to change the way you do business. And spending time and effort on that is not really something that you want to see as an investor, right? And I think the last challenge, which is probably more common to most Indian legislations, is sort of the way they're drafted and the fact that, you know, they have unintended coverage or unintended consequences. So I think you could still argue that, okay, these e-commerce marketplace regulations are intended to protect traders, small retailers, etc. But the way they're drafted, for example, when you look at an investment, it potentially covers services being provided on you or an e-commerce marketplace. And you have, there is just no rationale as to how a trader or a retailer is being sort of harmed by an e-commerce marketplace which covers services, right? That's one example. Second is, you know, was the intention to cover typical consumer goods, you know, be it phones, televisions, whatever it is, but what about something unique like a used car marketplace? Are these regulations built to cover for something like that? Was it intentional? Was it unintentional? But the challenge is that when you're looking at it as an institution, the sort of the reach of these regulations is so wide that you have to sort of ask these questions and see whether there is some, you know, compliance challenge or not. And that is, you know, truly time, money, and effort very poorly spent. So if you ask me, I think general theme is that these are all acting as dampeners on the sentiment of looking at foreign investment and e-commerce. So I think it's something that really needs to be sort of looked at by the regulators.
So Arun, as a follow-up to that, mainly from a foreign investor standpoint, and we know that India has signed bilateral treaties with loads of countries, and most of the funds come from these countries. How do you look at, let's say, some principles of, let's say, estoppel and all, wherein when you invested your first $1 billion into an Indian e-commerce startup, the regulations were different and it allowed you to invest and continue your business model in a particular form. Now, let's say 2 years fast forward, the government changes regulation for some reason or the other, and it makes your business very difficult or completely unprofitable. So you cannot make profits on your first $1 billion investment, and hence you can't make money or take money out. So how does the foreign investor think through these challenges with the lens of bilateral investment treaties?
No, Ashish, I don't think that any foreign...
I know you don't want to sue the government, but it is more of an academic debate, and I'm asking you as a lawyer.
I think I'm giving you the practical answer that these are all regulations which are prospective in nature. They're not retrospective in nature. They, of course, affect business as usual.
It stops the way you were conducting business.
Absolutely.
Unprofitable, unviable.
It does. Yeah. But that is equally arguable about any other legislation which changes the way you're operating, you know, as on today. It changes the way you're operating. So I think as a foreign investor, what you've now come to expect is expect the unexpected. It's cliched, but that's what it truly is. So, you know, you never know what's going to happen tomorrow. You have some inkling, but you are totally unprepared. And I don't think, you know, we're in a place where we really want to litigate against the government or have these companies litigate against the government, because that could lead to a situation where you completely stop whatever inflows are already happening. Right? And I think that is far worse than even operating in a restrictive environment.
Okay, got it. Zamir, you come from offline. I know that you love to buy online and you love e-commerce. I know that's your first love. But, you know, keeping aside your love towards e-commerce, can you be a bit hatred towards the e-commerce and, you know, give your offline perspective?
Yeah. This is like asking to hate your girlfriend, actually.
You're married now, so you should hate them.
So I can say wife. So, I mean, we have come from a stage... where I believe, so in terms of e-commerce actually and the experience of Information Technology Act and the various circulars we have today, I think the e-commerce market has really grown up, and therefore the government expected that, you know, I mean, we need to have control, time, etc. Because when I remember 2002, 2003, these things were into the realm of the business that, you know, let's have big market in terms of e-commerce, foreign, there are websites in foreign countries which are progressing. And the government was also speaking positively that, you know, FDI in e-commerce is a straightforward, you know, you can bring in money, you can start doing business, et cetera, et cetera. So we are coming from that stage where the government was standing with a garland and saying that, all right, come with FDI investments if you want to start anything in electronic commerce. This was a time in 2006, 2007. I remember specifically when in Reliance, it started companies like, there were gaming companies, there was a big adda.com, which was like an e-commerce website like Amazon. There was BigFlix, which was like a Netflix model, etc. And 2006, 2007, 2008, these were the real businesses where we were in fact talking to big investors in United States, Goldman Sachs and all that. And this was the trend where it started all picking up. Two issues we were facing up mostly, that whatever products you display on e-commerce website, either they are from the gray market, China, etc. So Nokia sent us the first legal notice on that. Second, you had issues about counterfeit products which were happening. And third were the credit card misuse or a fraud which was happening in terms of payment. So the payment you make to buy a product, the product is delivered. The credit card companies gave 45 periods to reverse if there is a fraud. So you lose your payment as well as the product is already delivered. These were the three broad issues. And that's where the government then started regulating these industries, saying that, we need to tame in terms of the commerce business they are trying to do. So the initial objective of the government was to address the marketplace for being a genuine marketplace, which we have on offline. Now, the trend started from that side, and then government started regulating on investments from the perspective that, if you have too much FDI, if you have too much, concentration on one of the companies, which is a foreign company dominating in Indian business, government then started thinking from the competition aspect. Now, overall, this is the journey what I see in the last 16, 18 years from the government. And today what I see is that the government is trying to tighten the noose by saying that, all right, if you are an investor, this is what the model we are here to offer to you as a marketplace. Coming down to the offline businesses like Raymond, like any shoe company, etc., what initially these companies thought is that if you are a business of clothing, of footwear, etc., it's about look and feel. This is what the discussion we used to have in the top management meeting, that you are a product of look and feel, and therefore you can't be on an online marketplace. But I think there was a time where the company started embracing that, all right, e-commerce trade is increasing. It's becoming a great marketplace from the perspective of whatever contribution it does. I remember sitting in a meeting where they said it just contributes 2% of it, and that 2% had then become 30%. So from an offline perspective, I feel it's not a competitive business, whereas online is trying to erode the business of any offline business. I don't think so. I feel whatever the regulation which the government is bringing in, government is only trying to regulate it from a perspective that, the business approach in the marketplace does not turn out to be a fraudulent transaction which is affecting the consumer. For example, if you have an offline business where you have a problem in your Raymond suit, you have options of going back to that particular offline trader or to pursue a consumer litigation. In the online model also, there is a similarity because there is a return policy which is given, and of course, if there is a defect in the product, you can always go to the consumer market. In terms of the data, we had the greatest discussion in the offline business that, today data is the new oil. But the offline businesses do speak that the data still existed before. They were only doing business offline yesterday, and today they are doing business offline as well as online. They used to rely on consumer data at that point of time also. Today, the biggest challenge which is happening is that in your offline business, your data was done by a market survey, and that survey used to be a complete privacy domain of the company which was doing it. Today, the option with the online is that you have issues which are coming up in terms of privacy, where consciousness has come up to the customer that a lot of data is out in the market for me, and therefore it is dangerous. So government is now trying to address this marketplace in terms of regulation and privacy. That's my take on it.
Thanks, Amir.
Thank you.
We have last 5 minutes. I have one question which I think seems completely common to all of you. Sometimes I wonder that these kind of finer nuances of how e-commerce business should be conducted with like more participation for the small-time traders and stuff like that, making it more open marketplace and not a closed marketplace. Should it be part of a foreign investment law or should be part of a generic kind of consumer or a trade law? Because I'm sure that we will very soon will see that big Indian industrial houses also opening up their own e-commerce platform. If the intent of the government is more empowerment of the mom and pop shop and small time traders, SME, I'm not too sure that fitting these rules under a foreign investment law is right, or it should be part of a neutral law which, you know, applies to the Indian invested entities also. Maybe if you can just spend 30 seconds. Yeah.
I think a part of it lies in the FDI. Part of it, we hope it lies in the new e-commerce policy, where we hope to see that the government also, apart from putting restrictions, also comes up with some scheme where it is actually promoting, domestic entrepreneurship in e-commerce. That's the aspect of the new e-commerce policy where we don't see any encouragement for any new things. So that's where we hope to find it. As far as the consumer issues that we spoke about, whether it's anti-counterfeiting or whether it is about customer redressal issues, I'd love to share this. As e-commerce companies are more maturing more about the intermediary principle getting diluted over a period of time, and taking a leaf from, you know, maybe a pharma industry or a microfinance industry, what we are more veering towards is, as an industry, we come together and have some guiding principles which are voluntarily adopted, so that as companies we also realize that no longer are we in a world where we say we are intermediaries and hence are not responsible. So it's becoming more and more visible to us that we would have to work with the regulators, the government, the consumers to build that trust ecosystem, which is extremely important for the industry.
Arun, your take on legal
neutrality? I couldn't agree with you more, Ashish, but I think I completely sort of agree principally that we should ideally have a level playing field regardless of the source of capital or color of money, right? But I think the other aspect is that even when you look at policies which are on the face of it looking to cover all businesses, like you take a national e-commerce policy or whatever, something like that, unfortunately the text suggests, for the lack of a better word, a more protectionist regime, or a regime, you know, more focused about on
Indian. Is it protection of the traders, or is it like protection of the big industry? You
know, I don't want to talk about this.
You are leading to the imagination.
I have no idea who is in the audience, so I don't want. But it is a question mark, right? It doesn't seem liberal. It doesn't seem progressive, and I think that to me is highly contradictory with all the other things that we are saying out in the open, saying that we want to be progressive, we want to be, you know, improving our ease of doing business rankings, etc. So there is a fundamental dichotomy or a clash over there, and I think that clash needs to be worked on, and it's neutral to whether it's Indian or foreign.
Samir, your take.
So like I said, that, you know, it's going from a trend to, you know, welcoming you on a red carpet and then telling you these are terms and conditions on which you can gradually work. So I see that particular stage coming up in the last 15, 16 years. I'm not a very big fan of press notes, because there's a competition between the highest number of laws we have or highest number of press notes. So what I would feel is that they should have laws in place, which should be, open laws interpretation, and then whatever is taken up in the court to form a system, because then you portray an open market. Because when you go in the market and say this is a court ruling, then it's quite receptive, more than having press notes for, you know, every bit and pieces of it. Because then it becomes too complicated to work in a business or run a business. From an investment or investor perspective, I think it's not a very motivating factor. That's my take on it.
Thanks.
Thank you.
So I'll just take two questions. Sorry, we are still pressed of time. So fastest fingers first, so you first. You are third one. Maybe I'll take three. Yeah. No, but you have to mix it up. Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah. And just address the name of the panelist whom you want to ask the question. You can be loud. I don't think you need a mic.
Anyway, hi. My name is Prankur. I'm from Johnson & Johnson. And my question is for Smithy. So there's this never-ending discussion about responsibility and accountability of intermediaries, right? So what, as per you, are the minimum approach has to be more preventive than corrective in nature? So if you can throw some light on
Thanks. I think the most important thing and the most feasible thing that an e-commerce marketplace can do is have a robust takedown mechanism. In terms of preventive, every e-commerce company has a due diligence process that it can follow to the extent it can. But when we talk about e-commerce marketplaces, the size and the magnitude of the operations are so large that an active policing is not possible. But however, the best that an e-commerce marketplace or an intermediary at any point in time can do is really, really work on its takedown mechanism, where, you know, we have obviously a lot of judgments by the various courts where they say what is the responsibility of an intermediary. Where it starts failing is when you don't have that kind of a responsive mechanism. That would be my understanding.
Thanks, Smithy. You'll increase your GMV, huh?
I'm Nabik from PNA Law Offices. And this question is based on the fact that the basic aspect on which the entire e-commerce function is happening is on the basis of payment gateway systems and the understanding that we are having with the banks. So when the payment gateway system agreements are entered upon with the banks and the financial institutions, there is a lot of negotiation on the clauses. Which are the basic clauses or basic issues that you find to be difficult to, you know, kind of negotiate with the banks in regard to these payment gateway clauses? And how do you deal with it? I mean, it's, I mean, it can be very general.
Is this a chargeable advice or is this a chargeable advice?
It's not a chargeable advice. It's because I've had an experience with as a counsel in the bank also, an in-house counsel. That's the reason why this question has been posed.
So I may be a little wrong on this, but when we have our negotiations with payment gateways, we don't essentially negotiate that with the banks. The payment gateways have their own arrangements with the bank. So if you're talking about our key points in terms of what are the key risks with the payment gateways business, I think the key SLA is in terms of success of a transaction and what are the incentives and disincentives related to unsuccessful transactions. So therefore there is always a keenness to see that, you know, your SLAs are very strong. The major risk is obviously data security, and therefore there is an insistence on ensuring that the API is secure, that the API sharing is happening properly, that they have the adequate PSI DSS, if I'm not wrong. It's always a tongue twister.
PCI DSS,
of course Ashish remembers. Certification. So data security is a major concern. Apart from this, can you think of anything else, Ashish?
So I think about a decade back, chargebacks were the concern, but I think after the introduction of, 2FA, they're not much your discussion on chargebacks. But yeah, it's a great question, great answer. Vishari, last question from you.
I had my question for Smithy, but I think it's been partly answered, and I probably, you know, will have my discussion offline with her. My question is to you, Ashish. Content regulations, which are responsible for censoring films and TV programming and other broadcast media, does not extend to Netflix or other streaming services, but they've started self-censorship. Are there any unofficial guidelines or directives in place, or they are afraid of policy being bought into cover censorship of streaming media? I put this down because I don't want to miss anything. So
we can talk offline, because I'm not too sure if there are media persons in the room and this is not the topic, but I'm happy to talk to you offline on that.
Absolutely.
Yeah? Thank you very much.
I was just trying to avail my opportunities.
Yeah. Great audience. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.